Item number, SCP-353. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. Biological hazard protocol is to be maintained at all times. Biohazard threat level 4. Full hazardous material suits, gloves, and oxygen supply will be required to examine subject. A disinfectant shower and decontamination spray are standard procedure before and after contact with SCP-353. The whole containment unit is to be kept underground, at negative pressure, and hermetically sealed at all times to prevent accidental contamination to the outside area. In the case of containment breach, all affected personnel are to be placed in immediate biohazard level 4 quarantine. Termination will be required in the possibility of an outbreak of one or more class 9 infectious agents. Subjects should be fed 3 times a day, as standard, and provided with the minimum required comfort items: a twin-size bed, a pillow, and a blanket. Clothing in the form of disposable surgical scrubs are to be provided as needed, but requests for items should otherwise be denied. Any outward signs of disease in the subject, such as rashes, boils, vomiting, or sickly pallor or demeanor, should be reported with haste, since the appearance of symptoms in SCP-353 means a willful effort on her part. Subject is to be subdued and questioned. Should SCP-353 need to leave its containment facility for any reason, it is to be fitted with an explosive collar, time-release drug delivery service for dosages of euphoric substances, and biohazard containment suit. Should SCP-353's suit breach containment, emergency sterilization procedures, up to and including incineration of the affected area, are to be carried out. Description: SCP-353 appears to be a normal human female, 26 years old, of average physical capacity and average intelligence. Subject has the capacity to siphon infectious viral and bacterial agents from her environment, nurture and store them within her body, and then redistribute them to devastating pandemic effect. SCP-353's mood directly affects the radius of infections recorded, with increased emotional states leading to massively increased potency. SCP-353 seems to be immune from the symptoms of said infectious agents, but just as long as she is only passively storing them, her active, willful attempts to nurture, manipulate, and change infectious agents while they remain in her body cause her to manifest symptoms ranging from mildly annoying to severe. Symptoms only last as long as she is actively inducing a change in the quantity or quality of an infectious agent, and thus rarely last longer than a few hours. Examinations have shown that the subject is able to store almost any infectious bacterial or viral agents within her body, though she is only capable of changing agents that are able to naturally survive within the human body. As of writing this report, SCP-353's blood contains traces of over 1,000 different infectious agents, including human immunodeficiency virus, or HIV, Ebola, Marburg, 67 different strains of the common cold, herpes simplex A, E. coli, cholera, bubonic plague, SARS, and malaria. At least 30% of said infectious agents were previously unknown to the medical community, and were possibly engineered by SCP-353 herself, making SCP-353 an invaluable resource. Addendum 3531. SCP-353 was originally encountered and data expunged, South Africa, where she seemed to be deliberately seeking to pick up strains of the Ebola virus. Foundation personnel pursued SCP-353 to Dresden, Germany, where they determined that she had successfully contracted Marburg and redistributed said virus to data expunged. Subject was eventually subdued by physical means and taken into Foundation custody with minimal loss of life. To date, her true identity is unknown, as she gives no name other than Vector and refuses to answer any questions about her past. SCP-353 claims to have traveled the Western world seeking greater infections for her collection. When asked why, she would not give a response aside from, "because I can." Addendum 3532. Initial testing has shown that she is as adept at manipulating and changing infectious agents in the bodies of nearby subjects as she is at manipulating them within her own body. She seems to prefer to manipulate diseases within her own body, however, as it grants her full access to the results of her manipulations. Furthermore, her ability to manipulate disease in nearby subjects means it's likely that she is equally capable of curing diseases and dispensing them. On a different note, personnel are reminded to refer to humanoid SCPs by their numerical SCP designation. Should SCP-353 refuse to cooperate, she is to be subdued and punished. We're not here to make her X-Men villain fantasies come true. Dr. Sarah Jarvey. Addendum 3533. Given that this girl is a walking time bomb of viruses, I recommend that we trank her, strap her to a table, and give her a massive dose of ribavirin interferon cocktail to flush her system. Dr. Addendum 3534. Flush her system? Hell no! Did you know that this girl somehow has the original strain of the 1918 Spanish flu, as well as a half dozen strains of viruses we've never seen? The research possibilities alone. Dr. Addendum 3535. Limited research approved. 05. Addendum 3536. The embrace of this vector persona, including the fixation on the color black for cosmetic purposes, her might makes right attitude, her desire to infect rather than to cure, and her disregard for human life all signal towards extreme malignant narcissism and psychopathic tendencies. Her obvious pleasure in manipulating and controlling diseases within herself, despite the often painful symptoms involved, are also quite troubling. Requesting approval for psychological examination. Counseling or therapy may be useful in reducing her difficult demeanor. Dr. Glass. Item number SCP-352. Object Class Keter. Special Containment Procedures. Containment area is to remain sealed at all times. No human interaction is allowed with SCP-352. Any and all interaction should be carried out via robot or other remote means. Should human interaction become necessary, full hazmat containment protocols should be observed. In addition, security lines must be attached to all personnel. Should any personnel begin to exhibit erratic behavior, they are to be immediately removed from the containment area via the security lines. Any staff reporting hallucinations after interaction with SCP-352 or her hair are to immediately be placed under quarantine. Any staff working in or around the containment area must submit to random psychological and physical testing. Anyone found to be contaminated will be placed into immediate quarantine. Staff attacked by SCP-352 may only be recovered if they have not been bitten by SCP-352. SCP-352 is to be fed only once weekly. Feeding will be discontinued for 1 month if SCP-352 attacks any personnel. Description: SCP-352 appears to be a very old, emaciated woman of indeterminate age and race. SCP-352 speaks Old Russian, but with an accent and dialect that makes translation very difficult. SCP-352 is extremely unwilling to communicate, with most of the conversations thus far made primarily of threats or statements of revenge. SCP-352 has never identified herself by any name, and due to her aggressive nature, it has been impossible to determine any background information. SCP-352 possesses a level of strength and speed much higher than what should be possible for a person of her perceived age and physical dimensions, and has been shown moving loads in excess of 200 kilograms with little physical strain, and moving at speeds in excess of 70 kilometers an hour. SCP-352 can recover from wounds that would be lethal to a human being, including decapitation and disemboweling. This regeneration can take between several days to several weeks, depending on severity. Internally, SCP-352 appears to be a normal human woman, with muscles, bones, and organs in a state consistent with advanced age. testing done on tissue samples has been inconclusive. SCP-352 is capable of growing very thin, hair-like strands from any part of her body. Apparently it will. These strands can grow several meters in an hour, and appear to be at least partially under the control of SCP-352. They have been observed crawling along floors and up walls and other structures. These hairs are clear and nearly invisible to the naked eye, and appear to be slightly weaker than standard human hair. The strands are also coated in a thin layer of chemical enzyme, identical to the enzyme in the saliva of SCP-352. SCP-352 produces an enzyme that is most concentrated in the saliva and hair, but is present in all bodily tissues of SCP-352. How it is produced, and its exact chemical makeup, are unknown. This enzyme reacts on contact with human tissue, and rapidly attacks the nervous system. Symptoms manifest almost immediately, and include hallucinations, euphoria, suppression of cognitive or logical thinking, and suppression of pain receptors. This state persists for several days with mild exposure, and can become permanent with high exposure. Bites from SCP-352 lead to high exposure in 99.9% of cases. SCP-352 appears to subsist on a carnivorous diet, with a strong preference for human flesh. SCP-352 will create a web of hair, and wait for prey to become exposed to the enzyme and become more docile. SCP-352 will often remove and eat the limbs of a prey item, to prevent it from wandering away, and can take several days to fully devour prey. Humans have been observed to still be in a euphoric state, and have no knowledge of the outside world, even as they suffer the loss of limbs and other bodily tissue. Addendum. Notes on recovery. SCP-352 was recovered in southern Russia, near the town of Reports of an enchanted forest and a witch who had caused several deaths were initially ignored, until reports of the witch being found and captured began to surface. When Foundation agents responded, the town was found deserted. Several bodies were found in varying states of decomposition, and blood trails appeared to show many more bodies being dragged into the enchanted forest. Recovery teams were dispatched, and captured SCP-352, but suffered heavy casualties due to SCP-352's attack and exposure to the enzyme. A large amount of hair was recovered as well, and is believed to be the cause of many exposure incidents, with contact being attributed to spider webs or an agent's own hair, and not reported until hallucinations manifested. Addendum. Notes on behavior. While SCP-352 prefers any type of human flesh over any other type of meat, it appears to have a special propensity for children between 0 and 2 years of age. After observation of highly elevated levels of cooperation, and a reduced tendency to attack staff while consuming flesh of this type, a possible alteration in the current diet is being considered. Addendum. The use of SCP-604 and SCP-1680 as a more efficient food source for SCP-352 is currently pending approval from the project director, following initial testing. Item number, SCP-336. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-336 is to be provided living quarters 6 meters by 6 meters in size, maintained regularly. This maintenance, as well as all other tasks requiring direct contact with SCP-336, are to be carried out exclusively by female personnel. SCP-336 may make requests for furnishings or items. However, approval of these requests is contingent on SCP-336's cooperation with personnel, and subject to the project's head researcher's approval. Requests for access to anomalous or dangerous items are to be denied. A voice modulator device fitted over SCP-336's mouth is to be checked and maintained by Level 0 personnel weekly. The modulator may be unlocked with a 6-digit combination provided to personnel Level 2 and higher for the purpose of testing SCP-336. In the event of the device's failure or unintended deactivation, Local lockdown procedures are to be respected until SCP-336 has been isolated. Description: SCP-336 appears to be a pale-skinned human female of otherwise Arabic or Middle Eastern descent in its late 20s. SCP-336 is 1.73 meters, or 5 foot 8 inches in height, and weighs 68 kilograms, or 150 pounds, as of its last physical. Subject requires no sleep or sustenance, and does not appear to be affected by aging or sickness of any nature. The object is anatomically human, with the exception of dermal irregularities along the thighs and calves, which appear structurally similar to reptilian scales. SCP-336 behaves impassively and detached with regards to human beings, and demonstrates highly introverted behavior. The subject is highly intelligent and analytical, having scored in the 95th percentile or above in most intelligence tests. A noticeable improvement in attitude is observed when SCP-336 uses a mirror, as the subject has been noted to be highly narcissistic, and has a tendency to spend long periods of time admiring its reflection. Human subjects directly exposed to the unobstructed vocalizations of SCP-336 experience one of two effects, depending on the presence of a Y chromosome in the subject's genome. Subjects lacking a Y chromosome and possessing otherwise healthy reproductive systems will experience inexplicable infertility. The duration of this infertility varies, but is directly proportional to the length of exposure. Subjects with a Y chromosome experience a separate anomaly that presents itself after 2 to 3 hours of exposure to SCP-336's voice. During an affected subject's next regular sleep cycle, he will instead enter a coma 6 to 8 hours in duration in place of normal rest. Over the course of this coma, approximately 100 grams of non-essential tissue, typically from the subject's rib cage, will separate from the subject seamlessly and inexplicably increase in mass, transforming into a full-grown instance of SCP-336-1 before the subject awakens. Instances of SCP-336-1 are various adult female organisms formed from disparate anatomical elements, selected seemingly at random from two or more genetically unrelated vertebrates. 90% of instances incorporate elements from two or more of the following species: Homo sapiens, Aquila fasciata, Benelli's eagle, Vipera amidites, sand viper, Panthera leopersica, Asiatic lion, Bos primigenius, aurochs, extinct, Echospherus perzowalski, Mongolian wild horse, and an unidentified subspecies of Capra aegagrus, wild goat. Current findings suggest that the genetic makeup of the affected subject directly correlates with the composition of the corresponding instance. Research is ongoing. The majority of these hybrids are not anatomically viable, and typically expire within 2 weeks. Surviving instances are irrationally violent, and demonstrate no evidence of higher intelligence. SCP-336 has demonstrated mild disdain for instances of SCP-336-1, and has been reluctant to discuss both the organisms and the means of their creation. As SCP-336 has been otherwise cooperative with Foundation personnel, the reason for this behavior is unknown. Addendum 3361. Recent experimentation has identified an irregularity in the object's effects on subjects whose Y chromosomes exhibit the Cohen-Model haplotype. Instances of SCP-336-1 formed from such subjects are exclusively Homo sapiens, with no hybridized anatomy. Additionally, these instances demonstrate intelligence and limited innate knowledge, including fluent speech in the subject's native language. Two of these instances have been retained for long-term study. Item number: SCP-326. Object class: Euclid. Special containment procedures: SCP-326 is contained at Armed Biocontainment Area 14. Due to SCP-326's severe iatrophobia, personnel who will be seen by SCP-326 are not to wear lab coats. Due to SCP-326's post-traumatic stress disorder, her tendency to undergo panic attacks, and the increased danger she poses to personnel during these episodes, SCP-326 is never to be beyond sight of a panic room, into which she can flee. The path between SCP-326 and the closest panic room is to remain unobstructed. Tranquilizers are to be added to SCP-326's food on a daily basis to mediate her stress. In the event that SCP-326 needs to be transported off-site, she is to be sedated until such time as she can be provided with a new panic room. SCP-326 is deaf and communicates via written Chinese. Translators are to be available at all times. All communications with SCP-326 are to be archived. Description: SCP-326 is a human female, approximately 65 to 70 years old. However, this figure is SCP-326's physiological age. Chronologically, SCP-326 is over 120 years old. SCP-326 has been subjected to significant body modifications by an anomalous technology. When inactive, these modifications are detectable only by subject's anomalous mass, 230 kilograms, despite a physique which would indicate a mass of at most 45 kilograms, and by the presence of significant keloid scarring along her arms, legs, hands, feet, and spinal column. When subject becomes agitated, the scars rupture lengthwise, and the components of a structure emerge. This structure resembles an exoskeleton made from human bone, and bestows upon SCP-326 enhanced strength and speed. The degree to which her speed and strength are enhanced is unknown, as she is reluctant to participate in quantitative testing. However, she has demonstrated the ability to, when in a panic, throw two 100-kilogram security guards over distances greater than 4 meters, and to travel over 20 meters to her panic room in 2.8 seconds. Due to logistical difficulties with sampling, not only is the exoskeleton extremely durable, its accessibility is limited to those times when SCP-326 is panic-stricken. The physical composition of the exoskeleton is as yet unknown, as is its connectivity to SCP-326's musculature and nervous system. Radiographic imaging has been hindered by the subject's phobic reaction to X-ray machines. SCP-326 is deaf, but still able to speak, as a result of having deliberately ruptured both of her own eardrums at some time prior to entering into Foundation custody. Her stated goal in doing this was to avoid hearing bad words. Further questioning on this topic results in SCP-326 becoming agitated and distressed. History: SCP-326 claims to have been an agricultural worker from the rural village of in Province, People's Republic of China, at the time of Mao Zedong's Great Leap Forward campaign. She describes having been approached by some young men who induced her to participate in a procedure for the revolution. The procedure was very secret and involved bad doctors, bad magic, and much death. Eventually, however, the young men stopped coming, and SCP-326 was left in the room of ice. This is thought to indicate cryogenic suspension. In 2000, a containment breach by SCP led to the collapse of several buildings in the Chinese city of Foundation cleanup crews discovered SCP-326 wandering in the wreckage, identified her as anomalous, and took her into custody. Item number: SCP-321. Object class: Safe. Special containment procedures: SCP-321 is to be kept in a regulation containment chamber. SCP-321 has been outfitted with extensive braces to make up for weaknesses in bone structure and muscle mass. Its artificial heart is to be examined once a month for any damage. SCP-321 is to be fed 3 times daily. Solid foods are excluded from its prescribed diet. 3 staff members are on temporary SCP-321 assignment at this time. SCP-321 is to be given 3 hours a day of exercise and physical therapy, with the rest of its time not involved in experiments to be confined to its cell. While SCP-321 is incapable of asking for anything, it has been allowed several stuffed toys. Description: SCP-321 is a human female, born on July 4th, 18... SCP-321 is currently 3.1 meters tall and weighs approximately 110 kilograms. Subject is devoid of melanin in hair, eyes, and skin. It is incapable of speech, but can still vocalize, and has proven to have problems with spatial recognition and awareness. SCP-321 has displayed a low degree of intellect, and has problems adjusting to new situations. SCP-321 was the stillborn child of junior researcher Adam and his wife, medical assistant Evelyn. Junior researcher took it upon himself to make use of several SCPs, including SCP-590, in an effort to bring his daughter back to life. The procedure worked, but the result was taken into Foundation custody for examination. The subject was later given an SCP designation. SCP-321 was quickly found to have recuperative abilities, capable of healing injuries inflicted upon it at approximately 5 times the normal rate. Subject was at this time entered into Foundation records as SCP-321. In the time since, SCP-321's body has continued to age at a decelerated rate, approximately half that of a normal human. Although its aging has been slowed, SCP-321 has continued to grow, showing no signs of stopping, despite now being taller than any recorded human. At this point in time, it is believed SCP-321's recuperative abilities stem from overabundant production of stem cells, a result of its interaction upon death with Expunged. For a period of time beginning in early 19, the limits of SCP-321's natural heart were reached, and SCP-321 was too tall for blood to be circulated properly. During this period, SCP-321 was restrained physically in order to keep its heart capable of pumping blood to the brain. Despite this, slow decay was evident, and the limits of SCP-321's recuperative abilities were found, as it was not capable of healing damage that was being dealt constantly. Work began in 1948 to create an artificial heart to prolong SCP-321's existence. The heart was completed in 19... Since then, all damage done to SCP-321 has been healed. SCP-321 has a very low intelligence. Everyday activities are a chore for it, and it can take several months to years to teach it to do such things as use utensils for eating. While SCP-321 has fully developed vocal cords, it seems incapable of learning speech, instead crying and making nonsense noises, as of those typically heard from infants under the age of 6 months. July 31st, 18... Requesting SCP-321 be removed from SCP status. Junior researcher Adam. Request denied. 05... January 10th, 18... Requesting SCP-321 be removed from SCP status. Personnel director Adam. Request denied. 05. May 3rd, 19. We can learn nothing more from SCP-321, suggesting we remove its SCP designation. Site Director Adam. Site 4. Request denied. 05. June 31st, 19. SCP-321 is to be decommissioned and returned to her family. Effective immediately. 0512. Request denied. This is the final time, Adam. She is not now, nor ever has been, your daughter. If you attempt this again, I will gather the council, and you will be removed. 051. Item number: SCP-275. Object class: Safe. Special Containment Procedures. Subject is to be contained within 2 6-meter by 6-meter, 20-foot by 20-foot subterranean cells. That is only accessible by a freestanding overhead elevator, although she is allowed short-term access to the communal facilities contingent on good behavior, and is accompanied by no fewer than 2 operatives, all armed with gas grenades filled with an incapacitating agent. Personnel are not to assist SCP-275's self-destructive behavior unless authorized by Level 4 personnel. Such behaviors are either potentially harmful to bystanders or pointless. Subject has requested 1 prayer rug, approved. 1 Quran, approved. Halal food, approved. To be allowed to perform a pilgrimage to Mecca, denied. Daily portions of chili pepper of a minimum Scoville scale rating of 1 million, approved, contingent on good behavior. Regular haircuts, approved. Hot coals, denied. To be flogged, denied. To be stabbed, denied. To be beaten, denied. To be shot, denied. To be electrocuted, denied. To be set on fire, denied. Description: SCP-275 is a woman who cannot be physically damaged by any means available to the Foundation. Subject is of apparently Middle Eastern origin and claims to have grown up somewhere in the Ottoman Empire, but to have been a homeless orphan with no memories before the age of approximately 10. Subject claims to be 168 years of age, despite appearing to be in her mid-30s. Subject is 1.63 meters, or 5 foot 4 inches, tall, and weighs 190 kilograms, or 419 pounds. Again, despite having an appropriate and healthy-sized figure. Hair and eyes are brown. She speaks most languages of the Middle East fluently, and speaks English with a mild accent. SCP-275 is perfectly normal in the fact that she needs to breathe, eat, and sleep. However, Subject is almost completely resistant to physical trauma, various forms of radiation, and extreme temperatures. By SCP-275's own recollection, her flesh has never experienced any damage, and her skin has never been pierced or scratched. Testing indicates that the majority of SCP-275's mass is composed of the elements common to all organic life. However, it is currently believed that many of the structural compounds have been replaced with significantly more durable substitutes, and the subject's tissues also appear to contain significantly elevated amounts of various heavy metals. Foundation researchers have thus far been unable to collect tissue samples. Attempts have been made to X-ray the subject, but results were inconclusive. Subject's skin contains significant quantities of radio-opaque elements, repelling most attempts to penetrate it with radiological or electromagnetic means. Diffractometry tests upon cell samples extracted from urine, feces, and menses indicate the presence of several novel polymers. However, the degree to which these polymers are represented in other tissues is speculative at best. This impenetrability of the subject extends through the entirety of the subject, including her hair and nails. Subject has claimed that her hair and nails have not been properly cut since she was 14, just before her condition manifested itself. In Foundation custody, her hair is to be cut by weekly exposure to a watt laser, and her fingernails and toenails are to be abraded with an angle grinder on a bi-weekly basis. In addition to this, due to her physical makeup and density, her biology has been slowed as well. Subject ages at least a fourth of the normal rate of aging. Also, her menstrual cycle is approximately 6 months long, with menses itself generally lasting for 3 to 4 weeks. SCP-275's mental state has been described by Dr. Glass as worrying. Because her anomalous condition prevents her from experiencing most forms of sensation, she indulges in self-destructive behavior in an effort to perceive tactile stimuli.
Item number, SCP-273. Object Class, Euclid. Special Containment Procedures. SCP-273 is held in an enclosure 5 meters by 10 meters in size, half of which is closed off for the subject's privacy. All major structural and facing materials of the cell are of fireproof and non-thermally conductive materials. A bedroll and other modest furnishings are allowed, provided they remain in the private section, and that all consumption of food be performed in the adjacent area. All windows from the observation room into the enclosure are composed of heat-treated glass of at least 1 centimeter total thickness, with an insulated gap in between. Heat and infrared sensors in both enclosure and observation are set to produce an alarm if any temperature exceeds 50 degrees Celsius. Observing staff are required to evacuate the room in such an event. Food in the form of raw meat must be provided every 12 hours for consumption, at least 2.5 kilograms per feeding. Other foods may be provided at SCP-273's request, provided good behavior continues. All clothing provided to SCP-273 must be either flame-resistant in nature, or be of inexpensive make and fabrics. SCP-273 is not to be interacted with in person if it has not consumed a meal of raw meat of at least 2.5 kilograms mass within the last 12 hours. In light of Incident 273-2, alcoholic beverages in excess of 50% alcohol by volume must not be provided to SCP-273, nor should any other flame accelerants be provided. All staff interacting with SCP-273 must be armed with non-lethal defense measures. Lethal force should not be used. Description: SCP-273 resembles a middle-aged woman of Indian descent. DNA samples and medical tests indicate SCP-273 conforms to human normal in all other respects, despite the subject's abnormalities. SCP-273 feels no need to eat or drink, but is perfectly capable of doing so. SCP-273 has generally shown willing compliance and cooperation with the Foundation's containment and requests. SCP-273 suffers from what it describes as a hunger, which requires regular feeding every 12 hours. This hunger satiates itself through a form of remote combustion. This produces no visible flames, instead oxidizing the subject from the outside in until reduced to a fine white ash. Metals are not consumed, except under special circumstances. When tested, the hunger demonstrates a preference for meat over other organic matter, especially live human subjects. SCP-273 exhibits no signs of conscious control over its satiation and becomes upset upon consuming live animals. In response to testing with D-Class personnel, SCP-273 screamed at data expunged into the corner of its private enclosure and refused to enter the front partition for 12 hours. Addendum 273-1. In the event of SCP-273's death, the body becomes the center of a large conflagration, marked by a central pillar of approximately 1 meter in width and extending far upwards. After the initial flames subside, all that remains of SCP-273's body is a pile of white ash with a corona of faint blue flame. The flame is not extinguishable through oxygen deprivation and requires no fuel. Over the course of several hours, SCP-273's body slowly reforms from the ash pile by consuming any source of raw material nearby, including the surrounding air. In this state, slow consumption of inorganic material has been observed. The new body resembles the old in all ways, with no signs of injury or illness. When SCP-273's body is completely reformed, it awakens, with no memory of events after its recent death. Incident Report 273-1. Date: undisclosed. Location: location expunged. The Foundation received reports of a thin pillar of flame exceeding 70 meters in height and resulting wildfires, witnessed in the vicinity of... Due to the anomalous shape and duration of the flame, a small MTF was dispatched to the location. Bodies of two deceased Caucasians, one male and one female, were found at the point of origin of the fires, the cause of death later determined to be severe third-degree burns. SCP-273 was found shortly thereafter, unclothed and covered in white ash, standing over a deer carcass, which radiated anomalous amounts of heat. Carcass crumbled to ash and coals at a touch. SCP-273 was cooperative at this juncture and followed the task force out. SCP-273 was then transported to Site for evaluation and containment. Partial transcript of interview with SCP-273. Interviewer: Dr. Forward. SCP-273 had been obtained the day prior and introduced to a temporary holding cell in Site. A video camera situated behind Dr. provided visual records of the interview. SCP-273. You are saying then that I will be kept safe here, away from people. Doctor, yes, 273. SCP-273, thank you. And by the way, my name is... You may use that instead. Doctor, noted. Pauses, shuffling of papers is heard. What was the first thing you remember from when you were younger? SCP-273. Long pause, followed by sharp inhalation. I woke up surrounded by flames and covered in ash. It was the first time, I think. Doctor, you remember nothing else from before that. How long ago was this? How old were you? SCP-273. Is it not proper to only ask only one question at a time? Doctor, answer the questions, please. SCP-273. I don't... It was a very long time ago. Probably data expunged. Doctor, and how old were you? SCP-273. 30 years. That much I remember. And I think I had made some great mistake. Perhaps that is why I am what I am now. Doctor, and what are you now? SCP-273. A demon. Note. The preceding interview transcript omits 3 minutes and 7 seconds from the beginning, and all parts after the last line for a reason. Level 3 clearance or higher is required for access to original recordings. Know that SCP-273 admitted in the former omitted fragment to involuntarily killing the 2 deceased subjects found near her point of extraction. SCP-273 also identifies the victims as old friends. Staff members working with or observing SCP-273 are to be reminded of this fact, and of procedure for working with humanoid SCPs in general. Dr. Incident Report 2732. Date: undisclosed. Location: Site. 2 Foundation agents entered the enclosure of SCP-273 with intent to question regarding data expunged. SCP-273 had earlier been granted a bottle of Bacardi 151 for personal use by Agent. It had been 12 hours and 37 minutes since the last scheduled feeding. Upon the agent's entry, SCP-273 demanded they leave. When they did not at first, SCP-273 became agitated, shouting at them and gesturing frantically. Less than 1 second after they secured the door, the bottle of Bacardi was observed to data expunged. Data expunged. Extreme damage to SCP-273's enclosure and observation room due to flames of unprecedented strength. Recorded temperatures exceeded degrees Celsius. One of the agent's deaths will be handled as per normal procedure. Agent is still in recovery as of this writing. SCP-273's ashes have been contained in an airtight, fireproof safe. The damaged enclosure is to be repaired for future use in containing other SCPs. Incident Report 2733. Date: undisclosed. Location: Site. The fireproof safe was found to be ineffective in containing SCP-273. Severe corrosion damage to the interior and hinges of the safe led to breach of containment, followed by the resumed revival of SCP-273. 3 kilograms of raw pork was left in the room, and the door secured. Upon awakening, SCP-273 appeared disoriented, but consumed the offered meal as expected. SCP-273 then requested to return to its original containment. As said enclosure has since been repaired, this request will be carried out immediately. Addendum 2733-2. SCP-273's activity has changed drastically since the death event. It rarely leaves the private partition of its enclosure except to feed, and refuses to speak. Surveillance using shows that SCP-273 barely moves when on its own, either sleeping or sitting against one wall. It shows classic signs of depression, despite having no prior indications of such a condition, recommending close observation for any additional changes in behavior. Item Number: SCP-239. Object Class: Keter. Special Containment Procedures: SCP-239 is to be kept within a one-room cell, furnished with one bed, one EKG machine, and one IV, to be filled with pentobarbital mixed with data expunged, to be refilled daily. Under no circumstances is SCP-239 to be removed from her containment area at any given time. The walls of this cell are to be coated in a telekill lead alloy. Only Class 2 personnel are allowed any contact with SCP-239 at any time. All personnel guarding SCP-239's containment area are to be equipped with telekill headgear, SCP-148. Subject's proper name is Sigaro Stephens Dautier. Under absolutely no condition should the subject ever be awakened. Any personnel found attempting to awaken the subject will be immediately terminated. Description: SCP-239 appears to be an 8-year-old girl, 1 meter in height, and 20 kilograms in weight. Subject has shoulder-length blonde hair. Upon closer inspection, the subject's eyes shimmer a gray-green shade. Subject seems to emit a previously undiscovered form of radiation, which has been named... These waves seem to be harmless in low concentrations, but in higher concentrations, they could break down matter on a subatomic level. SCP-239 seemingly has the ability to do whatever she expresses a will to do. Put simply, the subject can do anything that she truly wants to do, on a basal psychological level, as long as she is conscious. Fortunately, she only seems to be able to affect herself and her immediate surroundings. Therefore, if she can see it, she can change it. It would not be the most prudent course of action, however, to try to test how powerful she can be. She seems to be able to create and affect living matter. For example, when a D-class personnel accidentally caused her harm, she simply wished him away. Fortunately, when the subject was made to feel guilty for what she had done, she wished him back. SCP-239's self-preservation instinct makes her virtually invincible while she is conscious. Subject's skin cannot be punctured by anything, excepting SCP-148. As a method of controlling the subject's ability, she has been told that she is a witch. This, besides improving morale greatly, makes her believe that she is unable to use her abilities outside of a pre-approved list of spells given to her by the SCP Foundation. This will hopefully prevent any and all attempted escapes. However, the subject is to be kept calm at all times to prevent any subconscious wish of harm to herself or others. Origin: SCP-239 came to the attention of the Foundation very soon after her birth and approximately 3 hours after subject's birth, the hospital was destroyed by an unexplained explosion. The press was informed that it was due to a gas leak. SCP teams were dispatched shortly to search the site for any abnormalities. The only living person they were able to locate was SCP-239. For the next 8 years, the subject was raised under SCP care. As of 2000, subject is to be kept in a medically induced coma until further notice. This decision was made by data expunged. SCP-239 is permanently contained in Site 17. Note from Dr. dated 12-26-04. Who the hell thought it would be a good idea to tell her about Santa Claus, and then tell her it was just a story? Now we have another potential SCP to deal with, but we can't catch him because he is magic. Dr. A. Clef's report. My analysis of the situation has led me to the conclusion that SCP-239 is an unacceptable containment and security risk. Although several proposals have been made regarding using her for containing other SCPs, the example of SCP-953 and others must serve as a stark reminder of the risks of overestimating the Foundation's ability to control SCPs with reality-altering powers. I would therefore like to make the following proposal. A piercing implement will be constructed of SCP-148, capable of penetrating SCP-239's otherwise impenetrable skin. This tool will be used to kill SCP-239 while she is asleep, and her powers are neutralized. Because of the danger of SCP-239 awakening and resisting termination, it is my recommendation that the selected operative carry SCP-668 as well, in order to minimize complications. One of the dangers of this procedure is the possibility that SCP-239 will awaken and perceive the operative as a friend or good person, thus changing reality to match. It is for this reason that I would like to volunteer to carry out the procedure personally. A review of my personal file should indicate that my data expunged should allow me to carry out the operation, even after a reality shift of this nature. Clef. Item number, SCP-2317, Object Class, Keter. Site and Personnel Requirements. Under Special Order of 05, the following addendum is attached to the beginning of the file for SCP-2317. All personnel assigned to SCP-2317 must rotate out for 1 month of psychological counseling after 2 months on site. SCP-2317 is to be kept at an undisclosed location. All personnel assigned to SCP-231 will be transported there blindfolded from Site 19 by a route including no fewer than 7 different forms of transportation, including but not limited to aircraft, automobile, underground tunnel, and removal of the blindfold during the transport process is grounds for immediate termination. Personnel assigned to SCP-2317 must undergo heavy psychological testing before being cleared to enter the site. Individuals must score at least 72 points on the Milgram Obedience Examination, be unmarried, have no offspring, and express nothing less than total loyalty to the Foundation. Normal psychological screening procedures against Axis II disorders are waived, so long as the Class D personnel in question has the mental capacity to carry out Procedure 110 Montauk as needed. Personnel who express sympathy towards SCP-2317's plight and or express a desire to rescue or sympathize towards SCP-2317 will be transferred to another project without delay. Any actual rescue attempts will be met with immediate termination. Personnel who have served on the staff of SCP-2317's containment team are not required to divulge that information to others. No official record shall be kept of the names of any staff assigned to SCP-2317, nor will said service appear in the personnel files of said staff. While on site, individuals assigned to SCP-2317 will be issued concealing helmets with integrated voice changers to protect their identity. On-site staff are not to remove said uniforms in the presence of other staff members. Off-duty hours are to be spent in private quarters, alone. 6 Class D personnel are to be assigned to SCP-2317 each month for the purposes of carrying out Procedure 110 Montauk. Violent criminals are not to be used for this purpose due to the possibility of accidental fatality during the 110 Montauk process. Special Containment Procedures. Following repeated escape and suicide attempts, and based on the failure of containment for SCP-2311-6, containment of SCP-2317 has been amended to the following. SCP-231 is to be contained within a soundproof holding cell, adjacent to holding cells for 6 Class D personnel, assigned for the purposes of Procedure 110 Montauk. Cameras will monitor every inch of the cell at all times, and must be manned 24 hours a day. Malfunctioning monitoring equipment will be replaced without delay by psychologically screened staff. Doors will be magnetically locked, openable only by positive action by the control and monitoring facility. This includes all doors linking the main holding cell to those of the 6 Class D personnel. SCP-2317 is to be kept restrained to a hospital bed at all times, except for the purposes of Procedure 110 Montauk. Hydration will be provided through IV drip. Feeding will be carried out twice per day through feeding tube by approved medical personnel who have not taken the Hippocratic Oath. Under no circumstances are narcotics, anesthesia, or other unapproved medications to be administered to SCP-2317. Procedure 110 Montauk is to be carried out at least once every 24 hours by Class D personnel. During Procedure 110 Montauk, at least one Security Clearance 4/231 staff member must monitor the procedure by camera at all times, although the sound may be turned off if the vocalizations of SCP-2317 become too distressing. Following the procedure, all Class D personnel must return to their holding cells, or explosive collars will be detonated. Description. SCP-2317 is a female between and years of age, with data expunged. SCP-2311 through 7 were retrieved following a police raid on a warehouse owned by an organization called the Children of the Scarlet King. 24 hours after the rescue, SCP-2311 went into labor pains, giving birth 3 minutes later to SCP, causing a event resulting in numerous confirmed casualties. Foundation personnel immediately took possession of remaining SCPs 2312 through 2317 and, based on notebooks recovered from the cult, instituted Procedure 110 Montauk to prevent future occurrences. Addendum 231A. Current status of SCP-231 units. SCP-2311. Deceased. Killed during initial recovery operations while giving birth to SCP. SCP-2312. Deceased. Killed during attempt to remove fetus of second SCP specimen, resulting in immediate event. SCP-2313. Deceased. Self-terminated following a prolonged period of distress caused by implementation of Procedure 110 Montauk. SCP immediately underwent a event. SCP-2314. Deceased. Attempted to administer SCP-500. Although successful in that all traces of SCP were expelled from the system, expelled remains immediately underwent a event, causing numerous casualties, including SCP-2314 herself. SCP-2315. Deceased. Botched application of Procedure 110 Montauk resulted in SCP-2315 giving birth to SCP 1 hour later, which then underwent a event. Recruitment profile of Class D personnel was revised to minimize possibility of a second botched Procedure 110 Montauk. SCP-2316. Deceased. Killed during escape attempt aided and abetted by a Foundation agent who had been exhibiting heightened stress levels due to prolonged exposure to SCP-231. Said agent obtained possession of SCP and attempted to use said weapon to rescue SCP-2316 and SCP-2317. Said agent was killed in the resulting firefight, but a stray round resulted in the termination of SCP-2316 as well. Fetus of SCP-2316's SCP then underwent a event. In the wake of this incident, O5 level personnel voted by unanimous decision to amend personnel policies. SCP-2317. As of date undisclosed, SCP-2317 is successfully contained at site. Addendum 231B. Text of missive by O5. Dear friends, it has come to my attention that recently, certain rumors have surfaced regarding SCP-231. Due to the drop in staff morale, I have decided to address some of the more prevalent points. Yes, Procedure 110 Montauk is as horrible as you have heard, which is why only Class D personnel are authorized to carry it out. Yes, it does involve brutal. No. Assignment to SCP-231 is not intended to test your loyalty to the Foundation, your tendencies towards or anything else. No, SCP-231 is not a punishment detail. Yes, there are staff members who have been on SCP-231 and have successfully transferred out by their own request. No, not everyone who's worked on SCP-231 is terminated upon leaving the project. Yes, staff members who have been assigned to SCP-231 are allowed to take a Class A amnesiac before leaving the project if so desired. Yes, false memories are then implanted. No, none of the supposed methods for recovering or detecting false memories work. Yes, there are some of you who've worked on SCP-231 and don't remember it. No, we have not given up trying to save SCP-2317. But research in that field must be carried out with the utmost of caution, based on the increased potency of each subsequent event. Associated with each subsequent SCP specimen, there is a strong possibility that SCP-2317's event could result in an XK class end of the world scenario. This information is corroborated in notebooks recovered from the cultists. No, putting the poor girl out of her misery is not an option. Neither is drugging her. She has to be aware of what is going on for 110 Montauk to work. One final note. The Foundation does many distasteful things in the completion of our mission, but our mission is important enough that the price is one we must pay. Containment of SCP-231 is one of our most dangerous duties, not because of any direct danger to ourselves, like SCP-682, but because of the danger that our resolve will fail, that we will allow ourselves to either let down our guard due to sympathy for the suffering of an innocent, or that we will allow ourselves to become monsters through the performance of monstrous acts. Just do your jobs and save the philosophizing for the shrink. Sincerely, O5. Don't believe it when they say they're trying to save her. Why would they bother? They've got exactly what they want, exactly where they want it. Addendum 231C. Update. 2317's emotional response to Procedure 110 Montauk appears to be reduced recently, despite proper execution of said procedure, increasing danger of SCP undergoing a event. Two options have been proposed. 1. Development of a new containment procedure with higher emotional response than Procedure 110 Montauk. 2. Administration of a Class A amnestic to SCP-2317, allowing for a return to base emotional response state. Said memory modification is to be administered during execution of Procedure 110 Montauk to maintain heightened emotional state following memory reset. Please advise. The doctor never tells his god which one he really seeks. Instead, he hides himself away, and quietly, he weeps. Dr. Addendum 231D, Decision. Proverbs 132. Carry out option 2 at the first available opportunity. They're God's own voice. He makes the choice, declaring with their word, in fear and pain let her remain, lest she be like the third. O5. Addendum 231E, Aftermath. Ezekiel 6:14. Option 2 was carried out. SCP-2317's emotional state returned to 100% efficacy. Dr. subsequently committed suicide due to heightened emotional stress. We'll continue analysis of efficacy of treatment. The doctor's gun ended his run as he put it to his ear. As she was defiled, the pitied child, he gave in to his fear. Dr. Addendum 231F. Continued analysis of efficacy of treatment. Revelation 18:21-24. After some analysis, I have determined that it is not necessary to perform memory modification every time Procedure 110 Montauk is carried out. In fact, it is better to delay for some time before readministering the agent. Analysis of Subject 2317's emotional response indicates that efficacy of Procedure 110 Montauk seems to peak between the third and fourth performance of the procedure. The dread of anticipation of events seems to heighten emotional response for a time, before familiarity with the procedure begins to lessen the efficacy of treatment. My recommendation is that Class A amnestics be administered once a week during Procedure 110 Montauk. The calendar has been modified accordingly. Her memory, a fickle thing, the strongest shall endure. When her weeping starts to waver, their drugs make her mind pure. Dr.
Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.